All right, if you would, take your Bibles and turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to be looking at verses 13 through verse 20. I want to give you two verses as our kickoff text for tonight. Verse 13 and verse 18 give us the sense of what Peter's talking about in this particular section. I've entitled this part, Why Should I Submit? Why should I submit? And we're going to be talking about how God expects us not only to treat authorities, but how he expects us to treat those who are our employers or those that have authority over us. So take a look, if you would, at 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning in verse 13. It says, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme. And then verse 18, servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. Submitting to a boss may seem like something odd right now here in the middle of the book of 1 Peter. But remember that Peter is writing a group of strangers that are away from Palestine, and Nero is already beginning his great time of causing much trouble to Christians, many put to death, many put in the animal cages, and many that were lit afire. So this is that time when the authority in Peter's life and in the church's life were really very harsh and very hard and murderous people. So keep that in mind as we look at what Peter teaches us about submitting to authority, submitting to those that have authority. So submitting to your boss may seem like something that God wouldn't care about, but he actually gives us some very specific instructions about how we should be on the job. Somebody told me one time, said, I wish I was a pastor so I didn't have a boss. I said, how many people do I have in my church? The fact of the matter is that we all have a boss. We all have somebody that we answer to. In my house, I have Virginia and Terry both that I answer to. But we all answer to people that have authority in our life. So today we're going to be looking at the matter of authority and our need to submit to those who are over us and obey according to the Lord. Let's begin then with our first point. And that he starts out by talking about submission of believers to the government. Submission of believers to the government. This is verses 13 through 17. He gives us the command for this in verse 13. He says in verse 13, very specifically, submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme. I had a fellow in my last church who just touted his belief that Christians needed to obey the laws of the land and the policemen and the speed limits. And I rode with him to make a visit one day, and I said, you really believe in the speed limit? Yes, I believe in the speed limit. You really believe in stopping at the stop sign? I really believe in stopping at the stop sign. I said, then why do you have this, what do you call that thing you put in your windshield? It beeps if there's a policeman around the corner to keep him from speeding, right? I think if you go 60 in a 55, you leave your guardian angel 5 miles an hour behind somewhere. But here he's talking about submitting to people that have authority. Let's begin with the first point, and that is the command. The command. The command is this, submit yourselves. Submit yourself to every ordinance of man. Why? For the Lord's sake. Take a look at those first two words. Submit yourself. That means to bring yourself under the authority of something. Bring yourself under the authority of something. The word there in verse 13 is very closely related to the word be subject in Romans chapter 13. And if you remember Romans 13 talks about the government. It talks about being subjected to the government, those that are in authority. And so we find it's the same kind of a word. So in Romans, here we're learning that the believer is to comply with the laws of the government. Now, biblical submission includes both the acts of obedience and also the attitude of willingness. Now, I'm going to cover the other side of that coin in just a minute. But let me say that God expects us to act obediently, and God expects us to have a willing attitude toward the laws of our land. So the Christian submission is to apply how? To every ordinance of man. To every ordinance of man. In general, the exercise of authority in governmental institutions is in harmony with God's design for the order of human life, meaning very simply that God does not want anarchy. God wants us to live with laws in the land, and every man can't do that which is right in their own eyes. You know, we can go from here to California on the main road, but we can do so safely because there's a yellow line down the middle, and if we adhere to the law of the land, then everybody stays safe. So we see here that as he says in Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 7, he's saying again, here, even under Nero, we are to submit ourselves to every ordinance of man. Now, why is that? So we have the reason for this submission also in verse 13. The reason that God wants us to do that in verse 13 is for the Lord's sake. I don't care whether you're Democrat or Republican. You will have a bad politician in every place you go. The reality of it is we don't serve a Democrat. We don't serve a Republican. We don't serve those that we agree with and disobey those that we don't. We do what we do in the matter of obeying the law for the Lord's sake. Because the Lord, Romans chapter 13, is the author of the laws of the land. And God places the king on the throne and turns his heart whithersoever he will. Now, so the reason for our submission is for the Lord's sake. Our submission to human authority shouldn't originate merely out of a motive of duty. It's my duty or they're going to take my license away. It's not a matter of fear of punishment. I'm afraid that I'll be thrown in jail. And it's not a matter of not wanting to be found out or being associated with the wrong group. What it is, it has to do with our standing as a child of God. We obey for the Lord's sake, for the Lord's sake. So we desire the approval of heaven, and we submit ourselves for Jesus' sake. God wants us to do so so that he can bless our life. Now, the third thing I want you to see in verses 13 and 14 is the authority to whom we should submit. The authorities to whom we should submit. What does he say? He says in verse 13, submit yourselves, therefore, or to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be of the king as supreme, verse 14, or under the governors as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. So Peter provides a list. May I say it's a limited list, but he is including the whole thought of all properly constituted authority. All properly constituted authority must be obeyed by Christian people. It begins with the kings, those who stand in the highest positions of authority, and it goes into the other rulers serving under the commission of the king. Rulers at all levels derive their authority from God. They may think that they got it because they're so good looking, because they've got the best ideas. But people get their authority by God, represented, and they are representing God as a supreme judge. And they are responsible to God for what they do with that position. Now, these governmental officers should exercise their authority in the light of the fact that one day they're going to be answerable to God. They're going to stand before God for the way that they positioned themselves and the things that they did with the authority which they had. So Peter didn't say that we should submit only to the good rulers. That'd be hard to find, wouldn't it? He didn't say, just if you agree with them and they're good rulers, then submit yourself. In fact, as I said before, in Peter's day, Nero severely persecuted the Christians. Terry and I were all over this area, where all the new churches had been founded in Asia and Asia Minor and all that. And it was interesting to see where Christians who owned businesses in the main thoroughfares had certain symbols that they would use. Many of you are familiar with the fish. If somebody came up to you, they didn't speak the fact that they were a Christian, they would take their foot in the dirt and they would make an arc. And then the person that came to them, if they were a Christian, they would reach over and they would finish that arc, making it into the symbol of the fish, which meant you were talking with a brother in Christ. But there's also many of those symbols that were in stores. When you walked into the storefront, it was on the pillars of the building. So you know that that business was operated by a Christian. The Romans had absolutely no knowledge of these symbols. But you could see it in the stones in front of the building. You could see it when people would come up to each other in the street. That way you knew you were talking to, in a silent kind of way, you were talking to a Christian. But this was the law that they lived under. Because if the Romans knew they were Christians, they would have taken them and severely punished them or put them to death. So I want you to remember that when Peter is writing this, Nero is in charge. And Nero is the one who persecuted Christians when he was a ruler. So God required that we submit for his sake to every ruler. Now, a point does come at which Christians must disobey the rulers. If Joe Biden were to tell me that I could no longer read my Bible under penalty of jail time, I'd have to disobey my ruler because God has commanded me to read the Bible. If I were told to do something that goes contrary to what God tells me I can or cannot do, then it comes time to disobey those that are in authority, but be ready to pay the price. Be willing to pay the price. And many are in. Matter of fact, I've made this statement before. Let me say it again. There are more martyrs. There are more people in jail for the cause of Christ throughout the entire world right now than have been behind bars for Christ's sake in all the generations preceding this put together. In many countries, hands cut off, all kinds of torture, in all kinds of situations, all because they were Christians. And they willingly did so because God told them to do certain things, even if the government said that they could not. So, what is the result of our submission? What will happen if we submit for God's sake, for Christ's sake? Well, verse 15 tells us the result. It says in verse 15, very simply, "For so is the will of God, that with well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men." For well-doing, verse 15. That looks back to what he's been talking about in verses 11 through 14. Well-doing is by keeping authorities or by giving yourself to the authorities of the land. That's the well-doing. And by doing that, God wills that his followers should have an influence on unsaved people that are around them. And how do you do that? By your abstinence from fleshly lust, by your honest behavior, by your obedience to the laws, and by your submission to the properly constituted authority, unsaved people will see what you're doing and will know that there's something different about you. You break the laws, I can guarantee you nobody's going to want to hear your testimony. They're not going to want to know about your love for the Lord. The outcome of this kind of Christian conduct is to silence the muzzle of the criticisms of people who lack spiritual understanding. I can remember back a few years ago here in town, I walked in, the lady at Walmart had given me too much change. And I went back, waited a minute. When she looked over at me, I said, "You gave me too much change." And she said something I wish she hadn't said. She said, "You must be a preacher." I wish she had said, "You must be a Christian," right? But I've been in towns where the worst credit is given to Christians. They have the worst testimony for paying their bills. And sometimes even churches have bad testimonies because they don't pay their bills. And they have drugged the name of Christ through the mud. Well, he's saying by acting this way, you keep the door open with people to be able to testify to them about your love for the Lord. All right? Here's a caution in submission. He gives us a caution in verse 16. He says in verse 16, "As free and not using your liberty for the cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God." Christians, I think, ought to enjoy their liberty in Christ. But I don't think we should misuse our liberty in Christ. Not using your liberty as a cloak repudiates the philosophy of those who pervert liberty into an excuse for harming other people, financially, physically, or otherwise. How many things go on in the name of Christ on the evening news? And buildings burning and windows being broken, all with God's name in on it, whether it's Jehovah God or some made up God. Many things are done in the realm of religion as the excuse. And that's why there's so many people lack a desire to want to get to know anything about religion. So the Christian is free. He's free from the bondage of condemnation of the law. We're not under the law. We're free from the condemnation of the law. We're free from fear. You don't have to worry about tomorrow. God's already been there. He's already going to be there with you. We're free from the slavery that we had to the flesh. No matter what that habit might be, no matter what that problem might be, you're already made free from all those things. But your freedom is to be exercised in the framework of one who is a servant of God and a person who delights in doing the will of the Master. I can do whatever I want to do, but what I want to do is to please God with the life I live. I told somebody some time ago, they said, "Oh, you're a Christian. You don't do all these things." I said, "No, I smoke all the cigarettes I want. I drink all the whiskey I want. I smoke all the pot I want." I said, "I take all the drugs I want. I go to all the movie houses I want." I said, "But you know what? When Jesus saved me, he changed my want to." Amen. I don't want to do those things. Why? Because I'm more interested in pleasing the Lord. And in pleasing the Lord, I keep a good testimony with those that are watching my life. So this is the only true freedom. If you give yourself to bondage by sin and by the old life, you're not really truly free. And those who demand freedom from all restraint have already become slaves to their own demands. Now, lastly, we have a final thought on the matter of submission when it comes to submission of the government. And it's found in verse 17. I like this verse, because it kind of summarizes, brings all of it together. And he says in verse 17, he says, "Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king." He brings it all together. He says, "Honor all men." Now, that means to esteem others because they're also God's creation. And they're only should operate under the wisdom of God and under his love and under his care, even though they may be spiritually or morally twisted and fallen, they are still God's creation. So we love them, we honor them. Then he says, love the brotherhood. He's admonishing us as Christians not only to love one another, which he's already talked about, as individuals, but we ought to love believers collectively. We ought to love. This is one of the reasons why you should want to come to church, because you love God's people. When Terry and I go on vacation, we go to church. wherever we are, whether I'm preaching or not. That's not even the issue. Even when I don't preach, we go to church. Now, the fact of the matter is, every place I've gone throughout all the world, I've been in church on Sunday because I want to get to know God's people in many other places, as should you. Every member of Christ's body, not just your personal friends, but everybody is a member of Christ's body, qualifies as an object for your brotherly love. Doesn't matter whether of race, place, face, or grace. God says you should love the brethren. And then he says, fear God. Fear God. And that means to reverence God, to respect him, to stand in awe, humble awe at his holiness, his creatorship, and all the other qualities that God has that we're studying on Sunday morning. So to fear God is to possess a sensitivity against that which would displease God. We don't do it because we know that God would not be pleased with it. And that's the way we live. And then he ends up by saying, honor the king. Now here's something interesting. Peter regarded honoring the king as being so significant that he declared this admonition, if you remember, at the beginning of this paragraph, and now again at the end of this paragraph. He starts out by saying, honor the king, and he ends this verse, this section, by saying, honor the king, the one who is the source of all authority. God himself deserves our honor even more than the king, but we are, for God's sake, to honor those that have authority. The second thing that I want you to see, he says, not only talking about submitting to the government, he talks about submitting to your employers, those who have authority over you, in verses 18 through 20. So Peter's narrowing the topic of submission as we begin in verse number 18. Submission to our employers is the focus here. Take a look at the command, verse 18. He says in verse 18, servants, be subject to your master for all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. Now, he starts out by using the word servants. Servants spoke in that day of household servants and probably included both free men and also the purchased slaves. Two-thirds of the country or the empire of Rome were slaves, made up of those that had been captured in battle and whatnot. So in that day, there were some free servants in the home, but the multitude of servants would have been those that had been captured and put into bondage. So slaves were quite numerous in the Roman provinces and comprised a large portion even of the early Christian community. When you went to church, you were going to church with many slaves. You remember Philemon in the Bible, the book of Philemon? Paul is writing to a person who had owned Philemon, and Philemon had left him when he got saved. And Paul is telling them how to conduct or how to go to church together and how to live together and how to continue to treat one another. So here we see that this slave-master relationship doesn't exist in most parts of the world today. But let me say the employer-employee relationship is somewhat similar to what he's talking about here. So let's substitute those words because we understand what it is to be an employer. We understand what it is to be an employee. The command in verse 18 is for the slave, the employee, to be subject and to submit himself to the master, who is the employer. He's to rank himself under his employer, just as the believer should be under the relationship of the government, verse number 13. Let's take a look then at the proper attitude we should have on the job in submission. He says in verse 18, he gives us the proper attitude that we ought to go to work with tomorrow. He says, with all fear. with all fear. You see, Christian servants or employees are to honor their employers with all fear, with due respect. We should serve. And I've been in the private sector. I've been in the working world. I know some of the doozies that you can get and you have to work under. But with all fear, you give respect to your employer. That his authority comes from God, and that certainly doing that will help us to reverence God. Look at what Paul said to the church at Colossae. In Colossians chapter 3 and verse 22, Paul said, "Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God." We're not yes men. We're not yes women. We don't just do what we're told and then go back and fuss about it or complain about it. But we do so because we trust and we fear the Lord. And then he talks about the one to whom we're supposed to submit in verse 18. The ones to whom we're supposed to submit, he says, be subject to your masters. Now, a master back in Peter's day was a full owner, and he could exercise absolute control over that servant. Some were kindly. Even though they may have been unsaved, they were very kind to their servants. Others were very unfair and made life miserable, even for the Christians who were servants underneath of them. But he says, be subject even to your masters. He didn't qualify that as to good ones versus bad ones. Now I want you to take a look then at the endurance. How long should we endure the suffering because of our submission? This is seen in verse 19 and 20. How long, you know, somebody said, you know, if you get hit on one side, turn the cheek, but it doesn't say how many times you got to turn it. Well, Peter comes along and he says, you're to suffer even if it's difficult. But for how long? Take a look at verse 19. He says, for this is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully, for what glory is it when we are buffeted for our faults? Ye shall take it patiently. But if when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. Notice what he says is thankworthy. What should we be thankful for? He says you should be thankful when you have done everything that's right and you suffer grief for it. We ought to give the Lord thanks, knowing full well that God has marked it up for our reward. So Peter praised the attitude of the servant who was willing to submit himself to his master. And because of his personal reverence for God, that Christian neither rebels, complains, or cringes in a cowardly fashion, but he submits himself in a servant's position or an employee's position. For a slave to rebel or to become bitter toward his master was a natural thing to do. I mean, it's natural. On your job, if you're accused of something and you didn't do it or you're treated badly, to get a bad attitude, right? That's a natural thing. Everybody falls into that pit. For a slave to rebel is a natural thing. It was the meek and forgiving spirit, in spite of the unjust treatment, which Peter says was worthy of being thankful. I've had to many times swallow my pride and be submissive to the boss, and in doing so, had that boss come back to me when they had trouble in their life, their marriage, their home, and want me to pray with them or want to talk with me about the Lord. You see, if you leave the door open and you show that submissive spirit, even when you're treated unfairly, you'll get their attention. And so we see that words like submit and endure and be subject and take it patiently, that's all foreign to the flesh. What do we want to do? We want to punch them right in the nose. We want to tell them off. We want to make sure they understand our side. I mean, we want to ride them to the ground and say, prepare to meet God because you're going there right now. We want to be able to say our or have our say. That's natural. But we don't serve in the natural flesh. We're representatives of God in a foreign land. So each of us can recall occasions when our conduct has mattered, has merited a rebuke, patience at times when we receive the punishment that we deserve, has no special merit to it. We don't really gain a lot when somebody says things to us that we don't deserve. But imagine being buffeted. Imagine being buffeted or knocked around or made to suffer when you've done absolutely nothing wrong, but you've done everything right. And still, you take it for Christ's sake. For Christ's sake. What does the Bible say? It says in verse 20, for what glory is it if when you're buffeted for your faults, you take it patiently. But if when you do well and you suffer for it, you take it patiently, what? This is acceptable with God. God is the great scorekeeper. Amen? He says it's acceptable. The word acceptable means commendable. I would much rather God be commendable to me than to get my point across to be acceptable to you. God said, if you'll do it this way and you'll keep these things in mind, then God commends you. Remember we talk about hearing him say one day, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Terry, I was thinking about the conversation you and I had so many years ago when he came from work and had a very difficult situation. He said, but you know, I walked out and I gave it to God, and God took care of the situation. So I think about these things that y'all tell me that you go through and how that shows the maturity in your Christian walk. And it's acceptable with God, unlike not submission or not submitting yourself. All right, so let's all stand together, shall we?